Hello everyone, and welcome to today's Qantas Learn at Lunch session. This will be the last session before the summer, so we're gonna make it a good one. We're very happy to have you here. If you have any questions, you can ask them either during the session, and then it's best to use the chat. And we can also get to them after the session. At this point, we will also allow you to unmute yourself or possibly also turn on your camera so that we can have a little dialogue. So, who are we? We are Qantas, and we are a Dutch fintech company, and we help other companies to build new business models and to increase their financial efficiency with blockchain technology. We have started building public and private blockchain and cryptocurrency solutions in 2015, and over this time, we have always focused on the intersection between the classic financial world and blockchain technology. And today we would like to present to you our stablecoin as a service model, also what it can do for you, and then give you a sneak peek into our Nexus system. With our Nexus system, we have four implementations. These include asset tokenization, crypto brokers and custodian services, IoT payments, and the one that we'll be talking about today, stablecoins. So what are stablecoins? Stablecoins are digital tokens that represent a stable value. And these tokens are designed to trade at parity with fiat currencies, such as, for example, the dollar or the euro, but also against precious metals, such as gold or silver. And why are stablecoins interesting? Well, this is because of their instantaneous and programmable nature, which makes stablecoins very suitable for the demands of a digitized world. And since stablecoin transactions are extremely cheap, they enable new business and revenue models, while at the same time increasing the privacy of the end user. However, many stablecoins miss the trust that comes with transparency and compliance, and this creates risks for both merchants and consumers. For example, you could question yourself, are the stablecoins that I have really backed by an underlying asset? And can I convert them back when I want to? But also, were the coins that I have associated with money laundering or other kind of illegal activities? These are all questions and problems that we decided to tackle with our stablecoin as a service solution. Our solution is compliant by design, and it supports the conversion back from stablecoins to fiat money. And we know this because we work together with financial institutions who can provide a fiat backing account. And also, we work together with auditors who can check if all of the money in the ecosystem is actually backed by this backing account. The underlying technology of stablecoin as a service is Nexus. Nexus is our platform for automated token, crypto, and fiat transaction processing. It connects traditional financial infrastructure to public and private blockchains, and thereby enables businesses to easily integrate their blockchain infrastructure into their existing financial applications. Nexus is cost efficient. It makes it cheap to add additional points of sale. It is built with compliance in mind, and it digitizes fiat currency into digital money, which can then be made available to a closed network. It easily integrates into existing financial systems, such as SEPFI, and it requires very little technical skills to operate. The system has been in production for 5 years, and last year we had a near 100% uptime, or processing 30,000 transactions per day. We've also attained an ISO 27001 certification for information security, and we are currently working on our ISAE 3402 certification and acquiring an e-money license. One thing which is important to mention at this point is that we as Qantas don't issue our own stablecoin, but we enable other parties to issue their own stablecoin. And this is an overview of what such a model looks like. First, we have the issuer, who issues the tokens that are used by all of the participants in the system. These tokens, as I've mentioned, are issued and backed by the preferred asset. So this can be fiat currency or precious metals. Then we have the customers, who can buy the tokens from the issuer and use them to buy products or services from the merchants. What's interesting is that customers can actually have multiple accounts. And this means that it's also possible that a customer, for example, has a wallet for his car or a healthcare device. And this also enables IoT payments. Then there are the merchants who can sell their devices or can sell their services to their customers in exchange for tokens. Then usually there's also a financial institution who provides the fiat backing account to keep the fiat money on the other assets safe. Then finally, there's the independent auditor who checks if the tokens in the ecosystem is actually covered by the preferred asset. In such a system, the issuer is responsible for the KYC and the AML of all of the participants in the ecosystem. This means that merchants and customers need to sign up with the issuer. After they sign up for the service, customers can fund their digital wallet by sending fiat currency to the bank account of the issuer. When the money is received in the bank account, Nexus automatically recognizes this and creates the same number of tokens and then sends these tokens back to the wallet of the customer. After they receive the tokens, the customers can immediately start paying with them and buy products or services from the merchants. As I've mentioned before, these payments are irreversible, instantaneous, and extremely cheap. The merchant can collect all of the stablecoins over time. And when they want to convert them back to fiat currency, they can send all of their collected stablecoins back to the issuer. Nexus will again automatically recognize this, then burn the tokens, and then send the fiat currency back from the issuer's bank account to the bank account of the merchant. Then also we have the auditor who can check if the balance between the bank account and the number of stablecoins in the ecosystem is equal, while the regulator can check if all of the stakeholders in the ecosystem comply with the regulations. And that's it for me. Marie, over to you.
Thank you so much, Mark. I'm going to share my screen. Please, can you confirm that the system, that the screen is there? Okay.
Yes.
So what you see here is the monitor of the issuer. And as Mark has said before, the issuer is responsible for the KYC. That means that the issuer should be in full control of all the participants in the network, merchants and consumers. And what we see here is a participant of the network is blocked. So let's have a quick look what's there. And as you see, this customer is blocked, but because there is a match with one of the sanction lists. So we have a number of sanction lists in the system. This one is from the OFAC. And this person matches or has indeed 50 matches with the OFAC list. So it's up to the operator to decide if this is a real match or a mismatch and to permanently block or unblock the customer. Also, I do have a account in the system. And let's see what information is available about me. It's my address, my contact details, my bank details. I'm identified through a photo ID. I'm not a high-risk client. I'm also not a business client. My currency is with what I pay is in euros. And my trust level is trusted. I will get back to that trust level later. I do have one account. Yeah. And that account is connected to my virtual phone that is in the system here. And you see that the amount of money matches with the amount in my digital wallet. I could do a funding. And unfortunately, there's no credit card or anything connected to this virtual device. So let's suppose that I transferred 50 euros to the issuer's bank account, and the issuer will now fund this 50 euros. So it's the demo funding. Apologize. And what's happening now? The 50 euros on tokens are minted and sent to my digital wallet. And as you see, it's already there. The nice thing about this digital money is that you can instantly start spending it. So let's have a look at the account of one of my colleagues. Yeah, Katerina, she doesn't have that much money on her digital wallet, so maybe we could send her. This is the public address of her digital wallet. I copy it, and as I'm going to pay, so we send her a present of 99 euros. It's instantly processed. Yeah, so payment succeeded. And if I do a refresh here, you can see that the money has arrived on her digital wallet. Last but not least, I can also redeem some money. So let's do a cash out of 33 euros 11. So the cash out is on its way. And yeah, it's there. And this is the amount of money that has to be paid out by the issuer. As you can see, I funded 50 euros, but not 50 euros arrived in my digital wallet. It's a bit less. And in fact, this is the business model for the issuer, and I will get back to that later also. So the system comes with a lot of reports. So we have a lot of compliance reports and transaction reports. You can, for example, generate a report of all the token payments that have been processed this month. And sometimes that may take quite a while. So the process is in the background, and I will get notified as soon as the report is ready. As Mark said before, token payments are very cheap, or the apparently a lot of token payments are being processed currently. Let's get back to that view later and continue with another part of the system. Here it's about the identity. The system comes with 13 different roles, and it means that you can assign different roles to different people in your organization with different rights. So we have what we call the high risk roles, that are roles where people really can touch fiat money and or stable coins, but also get access to the API keys. and roles with low risk you would assign to support and operators that can view information but cannot change information. A role that is highly appreciated by our clients is the role of the auditor. It means that our clients can grant access to their auditors, and these auditors are then able to generate reports and access the data without the need to ask well their clients for the required information. The stablecoin system comes with a lot of documentation, so you can immediately start building your own ecosystem if you follow the instructions here. Once you have set up the system, you well might not need the portal anymore, but communicate with our technology through the APIs. So we have an, we provide an extensive set of APIs that with 30,000 transactions per day, as Mark mentioned, are heavily used by our clients. We do not only provide the APIs, but also SDKs. So the app that you see here is provided as open source to our clients. If you need support with implementation or have questions, you can communicate with our support team 16 hours per day through the well standard communication tool that is very helpful because it structures the requests and the topics our clients would like to address. Furthermore, the system as we provide it, we more or less provide two systems to our clients. First of all, there's what we call the test environment, where our clients can test their APIs, and well, we also test our APIs with them. So every client has its own test environment and its own production environment. There were some issues over the past 2 months. Here was a problem with the Microsoft Azure environment, so it was not possible, unfortunately, to sign up for the services. And some of you might have heard about problems with the Stellar blockchain. Early April, it didn't affect or have any effect on our systems, but our agents reported issues on the Stellar network. So let's get back one more time to the system, and yeah, we leave that one. So now we have an overview of all the token payments, and for example, this payment, the withdrawal that I did, it's indeed very cheap. So the network fee that was paid was 0.000031 lumen, and the crypto price of this lumen is 22 cents. So it's really less than a thousandth of a cent. A few settings, so you can set up the system as you like. I said to you that my trust level was trusted. That means that I as a person, I can buy for 1,000 euro stable coins a day, and I can also sell for 1,000 euro stable coins a day, and a total of 5,000 euros a month. A merchant has a bit of a different spending behavior. So a merchant might sell up the amount of 5,000 euros a day and up to 50,000 euros a month. And let's also have a quick look at the business model of the issuer. If you remember, I funded 50 euros and I got a bit less. It was 48 euros 85. And this is something the issuer can define for each and every different payment or sell method. So in this example, it's a 2% service fee and a 15 cents banking fee, and that adds up to 1.15 euro. And for the sell transaction that I did, there is a service fee of 6%. And this service fee is, as I said before, the revenue model of the issuer. It's very easy to define your own stablecoin. So I can create my own stablecoin here. It will be on the Stellar blockchain because that's the only blockchain that I've connected to this demo environment. So, but let's say that we are going to create a demo token, and the code will be DTX, and it's pegged by euro. And as I said, so the conversion rate is that 1 DTX is 0.0 euro. That means that 1 DTX is 1 euro. I'm not going to create it now, but you see how easy it is to create your own stablecoin. So if you would like to get some more background information about the stablecoins and our technology, I encourage you to visit our website, where you can watch some explanatory videos and use cases where our stablecoins are used. You can download the white paper and also a white paper about how our stablecoins are used in loyalty programs. You can also download the stablecoin app that I've just showed you for iOS and Android. And well, that's it from my side. Mark, over to you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Henri. So, as I said before, oh, Henri, can you unmute yourself?
No, I'm mute.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Now it's good. Yeah, so I've mentioned it before. We were founded in 2015, and over this time we have done a number of both public blockchain projects and private blockchain projects. And on this one, you can see the public blockchain projects, and these include projects with some of the front runners in the blockchain industry, such as Bitcoin Suisse, Bankfreak, and QuickBit. And then here we have the private blockchain projects, and here we usually work together more with larger corporates who really have an interest in integrating IoT payments into their existing systems to explore new revenue and business models. And we have here we have worked together with corporates such as Airbus, Porsche, and BASF. And about 2 or 3 months ago, we've announced that together with Tech Mahindra, we will be bringing our stablecoin as a service solution to global BFSI customers. And we are very excited about this because we believe that we have a superior stablecoin offering that can bring a lot of benefits for standard banking services in the US. And we've also previously successfully cooperated with Tech Mahindra before, so we are very much looking forward to the future. Then this is our own team. It consists of 17 team players, and almost all of us currently work from home. But we have a headquarters in Utrecht, the Netherlands, which we very much look forward to returning back to. We are highly experienced, and we can create and execute the solution that you are looking for. And for today, that's it. I and we hope that this session has helped you to understand what blockchain technology and Qantas can do for you and for your business. If anybody has any questions right now, you can either ask them in the chat, but I will also allow you to unmute yourself so that maybe we can have a little dialogue.
Hi, Mark. This is Ron Berendsen.
Hi, Johan.
Hello, good afternoon. There was a mention of payments being irrevocable. How is that achieved in the system?
Maybe I can answer that question. Hi, Ron. I think we've met actually a couple of years ago. We used the Stellar blockchain for storing the stablecoin transactions. And the Stellar blockchain works a bit different if you compare it to, for example, Bitcoin or Ethereum. So you do not have orphan blocks in Stellar. So the blocks, once they are in the blockchain, they are fixed. And this is because you have identified nodes that store the blocks.
Okay, yeah, if there's no...
It's a different behavior of the underlying blockchain ledger.
Thanks.
Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you, Henry.
You're welcome. Any more
Are there questions? Any other questions? You're welcome.
I think there are some in the chat. But... Yeah, so there's one question that I showed stablecoins, euros to stablecoin or to fiat money or euro. This is something that can be defined in the system. In the demo that I showed, it's we only have the euro as fiat money, but you could also have English pounds, US dollar, or Swiss francs. That is just a configuration of the system. And I see there's one question about the regulation you are using. So as Mark explained before, we provide the technology, so the technical infrastructure, and it's up to the issuer to clear the regulatory aspects, as long as they do not use our e-money license, which we do not have yet, but will be there beginning of next year, hopefully. So actually, it's up to the issuer to clear with the financial authorities in the territory where he wants to exploit his business model about the regulatory aspects. But in most of the cases, we work with a PSD2 exemption, and that means a closed loop ecosystems where the tokens can only be used at one or a few merchants within one vertical. I hope that answered your question. Any more questions that I missed? Or Mark, have you seen other questions?
No, I think that's it for now.
Okay, then thank you all very much for joining the last stablecoin session before the summer holidays. We will continue with the stablecoin sessions, as Mark said, after the summer holidays, and we will also start with our asset tokenization webinar. So asset tokens are and the handling of asset tokens is an application on top of our stablecoins, and the nice thing about the tokenized assets and the stablecoins on one ledger means that you can have an what we call atomic swapping. So you can have in one blockchain transaction the change of ownership of the asset and the related payment, and that means a lot of advantages for financial processes. But I hope you're curious and you will join us in the tokenized asset session then early September. Thank you very much again.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Enjoy the
summer. Have a good summer.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Stay healthy. Bye.